So, if I can find it, week one is a pen. So basically this week, you're going to be modeling a pen, either a click pen or a mechanical pencil. Don't use like a glass or a nib pen or like a number two pencil, especially a number two pencil. but anyway, so you're going to want to take a pen, used or new. Take orthographics of the assembled pen, and then you're actually going to disassemble the pen. So unless you've disassembled and reassembled said pen before, maybe don't use like your favorite pen that's been passed down through family generations in case you rip it apart and then can't put it back together. Like, be aware that you risk the pen when disassembling it. If you're concerned about that, you can always just go to the dollar store somewhere and get like a really cheap pen and like take it apart. But anywho, so orthographics of assembled pen. Again, I don't care if you use cell phone pictures, just make sure that the quality is reasonable. Everything's in focus, it's not really grainy, that kind of thing. Rip your pen apart, take all of the pieces apart, or as many pieces as you possibly can, and then take orthographics of each individual piece of said pen. It is very much unnecessary to disassemble the ink part of the pen. Usually they're clear and you can see things, and if you take it apart, you're probably just going to stain like everything. So again, you don't need to rip the ink part apart. Anyway, then you're going to go into model Maya and model all of the pieces of the pen that come apart with all of the details on them. So this is inside and outside of the pen. If there's like springs or like little mechanical gears, you're going to model all of that stuff. And then when I, I'll explain this in a sec, but when I snap the objects back together, they're back to 000, the pen should fit together into a finished piece. Again, I'll go over that in like 2 seconds. Once that's done, you're gonna render the pen. So you get two renders of the assembled pen and then two renders of the exploded pen. I'll show you kind of more what I mean about exploded in a sec again. And then you're going to duplicate those renders and throw some wireframes onto them, which, again, I will go over in case people need a refresher with that. In terms of model expectations, I would expect everything to have thickness with it. That's what it was. So, like, even a thin piece of metal or, like, a piece of paper, like, in the real world, that does have thickness. It's tiny thickness, but it's thickness. So if I ever see stuff in your scenes where it's just like a flat plane and I can see the backside of that plane, or if there's like a hole in the model where I can see into the model, that's something I would also take off points for in the assignment. So again, just make sure that everything has thickness to it. And then you're gonna, again, like model as much detail as humanly possible into this pen. So like, you know, threads on anything that screws apart, springs, bumps, like lead pieces. If your grip has like a weird pattern on it, try to get that in. And then the whole model should be smoothable. Pretty much everything should for this class should be smoothable. Like, I know game kids, like that sucks because that's not directly pertaining to your major, but that's just like one of the weird requirements for the class. For the extra credits, like have fun, do low poly, whatever, but yeah. And then other thing, like model should be on some kind of background. Again, default expectation is like at least a gray plane. Something nicer obviously would be better. And then for what to submit, the 8 renders mentioned above, so these guys here, the Maya file with 2 versions of your object in it. So one exploded and one assembled version of this pen. And then any orthographics and reference you used for like pictures of the pen. I would actually also recommend if you're using a single pen, so it was suggested to maybe go to the dollar store and get like a pack of the same type of pen, that way you can take one apart and have one assembled at all times next to each other. If you do decide to use a pen or pencil that you have already, just make sure that you take a lot of pictures of the thing before you rip it apart in case you can't get it back together. And then I would also recommend maybe taking a video of you disassembling it, so you just have a record of, you know, if you happen to throw everything in a Ziploc bag, you have a record of like what the pieces are and how they fit back together, just so you can use the pen when you're done with it. Are there any questions about the requirements of the assignment?
How do you get the wireframe visible?
Yeah, I'm gonna go over that in a sec. But yeah, actually, I'm just gonna go over that stuff and then see if people have questions. That probably make more sense. Monitors are terrible. All right. So I'm just gonna run through really quick and just go through like all of the, I guess, basic stuff that I mentioned in the pen. So if this, dear God. All right. So say I'm just gonna make this is like gonna be the ugliest fake pen model that has ever existed. All right. So here's my like hideous fake pen. You know, imagine that this is maybe like the clip on the pen or something. So basically what I would want to do, again, these should really be labeled in the outliner, you know, pen body, spring, thumb, clicky piece, I don't know. They should be labeled. So basically what I want to do, I'm just going to duplicate these for the things. So when I say, when all the objects should snap back to be an assembled pen, if I zero them all out, if I select all of these objects here, and I zero out all of their translations, I probably won't touch rotation, but like if I zero this out, it should snap back to being an assembled pen. So in this case, I mean, this is more of like the assembled pen look that I was going for. So all I would want to do here, I can do one of two things. I can right click in the channel box, go down to freeze, and I can do, here I could do translate only, rotate only, scale only. In this case, I'm just going to do all. But you can see that it took whatever values that were there and set them all to either 0 or 1 for scale. So that way, if I move this object around really crazy, what am I doing? You know, rotated it, whatever. Once I selected all of these objects, I could just zero out all of these values, and it snaps back to being an assembled pen. Does that make sense? Cool. The other way you can do that, if you just want to freeze all, is just, again, select your objects. This weird little button with the snowflake and the three zeros will also do the exact same thing. But yeah. So ideally, again, so for the assignment, when I say it's like assembled pen, when I say exploded pen, I basically just mean like pull all of the parts apart so you can see like the inner workings of the pen. And obviously like your pens would look way better than this and have more detail and like more stuff in them. But you take like basically, again, all the pieces of your model and just separate them. You can lay them out however you want. I found like it's usually pretty logical to maybe do like the outer layer in like one column here. So like pull out, you know, the body of the pen, the little clicker pen. And then on the inside here, like do another layer next to it with like the springs and like the inner stuff of the pen, just kind of like efficient space-wise. Because these pens are probably gonna have like 20 components each to them. Does that make sense? Cool. So then when I say, yeah. So again, so when I say like if your exploded pen is like this and I wanna move it back into place, I just wanna be able to be like zero everything and then have it pop back into place. When I look in your Maya file, again, this stuff should probably be labeled. And when I say probably, I mean it should be labeled. But it should be organized in a way, so if I hit Control G, I'm just gonna group this together and now I can say exploded. And I can take all of these guys and say assembled. And that way, if I look in the outliner, it's still all separate pieces of mesh. So I can, you know, click on each individual piece of this and see what's happening with it. But it's just an easy way for me to be able to access the different stuff in your scene that's a little bit more organized, if that makes sense. So again, select the objects and do Control G. And that'll group all of the pen stuff together. So when I say Myify will two versions of the object, one exploded, one assembled, this is what I mean. And then, so again, usually I do find grouping preferable to doing a mesh combine, because if I do a mesh combine on this, I no longer have control over which pieces of this model is smooth and not smooth. Strictly speaking, everything for this class should be smoothed, but again, I have no control over it if I for some reason need control. It also gets rid of any translation or rotation values I have. So if I mesh separate this, you'll notice that this is zeroed out. Like I can't, There's no way for me to just sort of like snap this back into the appropriate position. So again, that's usually why I'll group something instead of doing a mesh combine. Usually I only mesh combine if I don't care about any of the like rotation translation values, anything like that. Or if I actually like want it to be a single object because I'm like, you know, attaching stuff together. That makes sense? Cool. I think that's pretty much all the stuff for that. So really quick, I'm gonna show you how to overlay, how to render a wireframe. I'm just gonna show you Arnold today. For some reason, Redshift isn't working on these computers. There is in the Week 1 folder thing on Drive, there's actually a little tutorial left over about how to do it in all three render engines if you want to. But again, for today, I'm just gonna demo Arnold. So I'm going to make two beautiful cylinders. Huzzah. And I will make, actually, why? Incidentally, if you go into create polygon primitives, you can turn on interactive creation, which for some reason I like prefer. I like being able to drag the size of my stuff as I make it. I don't know why. I just think it's nice. This is gonna be my object, and it's gonna be gorgeous, and I'm gonna just throw in a crappy Skydome light. Which, remember, should totally have an HDR mapped into it, but for the purposes of this, shrugs. And I'm just gonna assign this an Arnold material, standard surface, red. And I will make this some vaguely reddish color. Alright, this is mostly just for demo purposes. So I'm gonna render this. It's gonna be really ugly. yes, I'm going to render this. Yes. And it is. It's hideous. All right. So here's my like gorgeous ugly rendered object. I'm just going to save this. Incidentally, if you guys ever have issues with your renders for like individual renders from the render view, saving darker than you expect them, make sure that you have color manage image select and not raw image. This will save it darker and this will save it with like whatever it looks like here is how it's going to actually save that image. So I'm just going to say this is a PNG. Name it a thing. All right, so this is basically my render, which presumably is you're happy with, theoretically, for some reason. It's ugly for a number of reasons. However, to render out a wireframe, so it does require a little bit of like compositing afterwards. You will need to take in like Photoshop or something to attach the images together, but I'm just gonna right click and do assign new material, and go to the Arnold tab, and do AI wireframe. And now if I render this, you can see it just renders with this like really horrific wireframe on it. There's like two settings that I usually adjust. The first, clearly these meshes are not tessellated. Please set edge type to polygons and not triangles. I honestly don't know why that's a thing that it defaults to, but you can see that once you do that, it'll, you know, render everything not as triangles. You can adjust the line width, so like in this case, I'm gonna make it darker so you guys can wider so you guys can see it. And then for some reason, if you want to, you can adjust the color of the lines and background. I never do this. I find it horrific and hard to work with. So I usually just leave line color as black and fill type as white. And you will notice, I'm gonna delete the background light in there. You'll notice that this material renders regardless of the lighting you have in your scene, unlike normal Arnold materials. So again, no lights required to use these. So I'm just gonna go ahead and save this image and wire two. Same as a PNG. And then once you have Photoshop open, you can take those beautiful images that you've created in the default Maya project folder, because I'm bad. All right, so I'm going to take wireframe 2, throw it into here, and wire 2. So just pretty much stick the images on top of each other. If you've rendered from the same camera angle, they should overlay perfectly on top of each other. And then all you need to do, because this is just a black and white image, instead of having this set to normal here, just select your wireframe and set it to multiply. And you can see that now your wireframe is overlaid nicely onto your image. You can also, you know, if you want, go through and like adjust the opacity or whatever, you know, make any other mods like that. But that's usually how I do wireframes. So this is what you would want to do for individual frames. If you guys are ever rendering out like a turntable or something, any self-respecting video editor that you're going to be using to compile your stuff is going to be able to do the same functionality, like make two layers of, like a layer of your base render and then a layer of your wireframe render and just set it to multiply. Like I've checked pretty much everything you use, like DaVinci Resolve, After Effects, they can all do this, again, pretty much the exact same way as Photoshop. Same process, basically. And it'll do it to all of your images at once, so you don't need to go through and like manually do this to 300 images. That makes sense? Cool. No. I want that image forever. All right, so the only thing, there's like one thing that I just like want to, I guess, point out really quick, at least about the Arnold wireframe. You will notice that, so I'll turn on, you can see here, like clearly this mesh is a lot denser than this guy here. And the reason that is, so if I unsmooth that object, you see it goes back to being, you know, the normal kind of thing. For Arnold, when you smooth your object with the 3 key, it basically adds in, and it will render that like fake geometry that it's adding in to get that smoothed effect. So if you ever render your object and you're like, oh my god, this is way denser than it looks on my model, like, don't freak out, that's just what's happening. As far as I know, there's not a way to turn that off. If I find one, I'll let you know. But yeah, so again, nothing to really like worry about, it's just kind of what happens. Incidentally, if you guys are smoothing your models, you should be smoothing your wireframe objects too, or else the wireframes are not going to overlay correctly onto your objects. They'll probably be like floating around on the side awkwardly. That's pretty much wireframes. Any questions on that? Cool. Usually these render like super fast too, which is honestly just glorious. So if you guys are ever, you know, looking for a way to spice up your turntables or whatever, you could just render out a little pass with this and then just export it from, or like compile them onto your original turntable. All right, so that's pretty much the stuff for the assignment tonight. Does anybody have any questions about what to submit? All right. In that case,